When it's time to party, we will party hard.
What is going on, everybody? This is the KR Scoreboard. Welcome back. If you guys are previous listeners, if you guys are new, thank you for joining us today. This is Cheese Ray over here, and I got my buddy over here, Darth.
What's going on, everybody? How y'all doing? Had a great week of football last weekend.
Oh, dude, it was such a great fucking football game. Such a great football game on the Thursday night, Sunday nights, and Sundays and Sunday night, and Monday night. That made me mad, but whatever.
You know, there's a lot of action this past weekend, a lot of interesting matchups, a lot of records also broken and still intact and looking to be broken on this coming up weekend. So it was very interesting. I enjoyed all the action that we got from the NFC West gauntlet that we had last week. I enjoyed seeing the New York teams coming out and showing that they've got a little bit of spirit, a little bit of spunk in them left, and could come out and play a good game against a couple of decent teams.
You know, Tennessee was very quiet on Sunday because it sounded like the Vols played on Sunday.
Well, the Vols played Saturday and took all the momentum with them into their game.
I don't know, man. That game sucked.
So, the Vols had all that momentum and everything, so I think that's why the Titans sucked. But this ain't college football podcast. This is NFL.
Yeah,
we won't talk that game.
We're going to talk about adults, some big old grown men. Grown-ass men.
Hey, there's some grown-ass men in college.
Yeah, that's sad if you say that.
There's some grown men in college.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Okay.
You can believe it.
I believe it.
All right. Well, while we get done picking at each other for a minute, let's go ahead and get into the recap of last week. Where do you want to start off last week? You want to start New York, New York? You want to start NFC West Gauntlet?
Man, let's just start with the NFC Gauntlet because I know we're going to talk quite a bit about the Jets.
The NFC West Gauntlet, yeah, let's do that then.
All right, so this first game I want to talk about is the Seattle Seahawks defeated the San Francisco 49ers 20-21.
Congratulations.
I am so happy about that. That was one of our picks from last week and choosing on going on this week. Wilson showed up. I'm very happy with it, but it looks like nothing changed. There's no running game involved.
I'll say this. I think Seattle got away with having an injury to Garoppolo. And I think that Seattle has to really work on their defense and their line.
Yeah, the offensive line and the defense needs to be worked.
The run game is not going to do anything if the line's not better. Alex Collins did a decent job last weekend. Carson is one of those guys that, I mean, you can't depend on him to be a number one, but Alex Collins, he kind of showed he could carry the ball a little bit. Maybe they might be able to use him as a tandem, take a little bit more pressure off Carson. I know they've been looking for somebody since Penny's been hurt, but you got to get that line fixed.
Man, fuck Collins, man. He sucked. He really, really sucked. He reminded me of Chris Carson. He reminded me of a Chris Carson. Not much of a Marshawn Lynch. Not much of a Penny. Because I know for so long they've been getting the power backs. Getting their aggressive power backs. Now you're seeing Penny as more of a acceleration, more of a what is that?
Speed back, a scat back?
Yes, speed back. Thank you. It's more of a speed back. And that's different. Mm-hmm. And now you're having Collins, which is a power back. He sucks. That touchdown was okay, but, man, he only did 44 yards.
Well, you know, a lot of that is because that line is just so porous.
Russ
had three sacks on him, but there should have been a lot more. You got to give credit to Russell Wilson. If he don't get MVP for the stats that he puts up on the board, give him MVP for how he can extend plays and make something out of nothing.
Yes.
Because he had to run the other side of the field and throw it across the field half the damn time.
Oh, my God.
Yes. I mean, it was ridiculous.
It was stupid. But, man, like you're going back on that defense was pretty shitty on Seattle's point because that one play when he just had, what was it, the wide receiver for the San Francisco, number 19, I can't remember his name right now. But he ended up going on the outside, and Who was it? Hold on. Give me a minute. I'm actually going to look this up. It was, yeah, it was Samuel.
Debo Samuel. Yeah, Debo Samuel had a heck of a game. 8 catches, 156 yards.
He was wide open. Wide open. No one near him. And after that play, Jamal Adams screamed at everybody like, where the fuck were you guys at? I can't cover both of them.
Yeah, that's pretty,
like, that was
pretty
bad.
Brazen coming from Jamal Adams, and who had a dropped interception himself.
Yeah, that was bad. That was bad. But then again, he did deflect the pass. I like him seeing out there more. I didn't see him in the backfield more often.
It's good to see him in the back, in the secondary doing some stuff.
In the secondary. I didn't see him on the line at all. I didn't see him in the middle linebacker section that much. He didn't blitz that much, but he was more on the back trying to see if I can still catch.
Well, that might be what they need to do with their defense. Their defensive line really is hurting too. Carlos Dunlap's been hurting with injury here lately and not been able to.
Why did you hand me your fucking e-cig? Why did you hand me that when I'm sitting here with a cigarette wanting a lighter?
Well, you know, you asked for something, I gave you something. I was trying to help you out, buddy.
All right. I'll thank you for saving my life. We're going back on that. All right, so, like you were saying.
But, you know, that defensive line has been hurting a lot. The secondary doesn't look like it's a very strong secondary right now. Just a lot of problems with Seattle. Seattle gets into the playoffs, buddy. I'm going to be honest. It's going to be a bottom wild card seed. It's not going to be a top seed.
It's not going to be a top seed because the way our conference is stupid.
And we may end up meeting each other in that first round of the playoffs. Who knows?
It looks like.
It might be a Dallas-Seattle first round playoff game.
And you and me are going to be so
Someone
mad.
Will end up dying that night.
We'll probably have to go out to the bar. And like, or B-dubs, and like being around a public area.
There will have to be people there.
Yeah, there have to be people there. Because you meet by ourselves, we will kill each other.
One for people to separate us, and two for witnesses.
Yes, who started it? Exactly.
Hey, who ended it?
Yes.
More importantly.
Yeah, more importantly, you smart ass motherfucker.
And who won the game? That's the most important.
But I know you are very excited, even though you didn't pick the Cowboys.
Oh.
How excited were you today on Sunday?
I was excited. Cowboys look like they've got a really strong offense and defense. There's some injury issues the Cowboys are having to deal with on the defensive side. Some COVID restriction issues as well. But they played a really good Carolina defense and put up a lot of yards and a lot of points. And Sam Darnold is no slouch, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, no.
No slouch. Sam Darnold needs to sue Adam Gase right now.
Yeah, he needs to do something.
The city of New York needs to sue Adam Gase right now.
Seeing Sam Darnold throwing another 300 yards, another two touchdowns.
It wasn't even just that. Look how many rush yards he had in two touchdowns.
He did. He had 35 yards rushing.
He was running the speed option.
Yep. It was stupid. He was stupid.
How many times the Cowboys had him on 3rd and 14 and all of a sudden he'd break off a run or throw it to Moore, who had an amazing catch. How did he stay up on his feet when he got hit? I have no idea. But
that was
a
great game.
He pivoted around and made a great play. It was a really good game, a fun game to watch. Cowboys owned the third quarter with 20 points.
Yeah, but man, Zeke Elliott showed up.
Zeke Elliott showed up, finally. Finally, Cowboy Nation. We can look at Zeke and say thank you. After 2 years, Zeke, we might start feeding you more now. Pollard looked like he had a little bit of an off game, but he still had 67 yards.
For just 10 carries.
Yeah, I mean, so Pollard wasn't looking bad. The passing yardage wasn't, you know, really up there, but 4 touchdowns for Dak. Completion percentage very high, going 14 for 22. Rating at a 130. I mean, great. Great job.
Yeah, it was a great game.
Cowboys look good. And I'm going to say this, Trayvon Diggs, defensive player of the year it looks like, 5 interceptions, 4 games, and Micah Parsons looks like he might be the defensive rookie of the year. My opinion, if you got the defensive player and the defensive rookie of the year on your team, defense wins championships. But I'm not saying that.
You've been saying that for so long.
I'm not saying that.
Yeah, you are.
I'm not saying nothing.
But, okay, so the other games we're going to be talking about is, what, Cincinnati Bengals facing the Jags. Okay, even though this was a little blah, blah game on Thursday.
This was a surprise game, to be honest, with the way Jacksonville came out and looked like they were going to own the game for a little bit. 14-0 at the end of the first half.
Yeah.
I was really surprised.
But hey, it was a rematch from back in college championships. Boro facing Lawrence.
That was. And
Boro did the same thing he did last time. I'm going to beat your ass. And he did. He beat his ass 24-21. It was a close game by a fucking field goal. But Joe Boro showed up with the stats of 348 yards and 2 touchdowns. When Trevor Lawrence over in the Jags didn't even do no touchdowns, no interceptions, and only did 200 yards.
He did, but, you know, getting the touchdowns on passing for Lawrence right now is going to be really hard with who he's got to pass it to. Chenault did a really good job of being able to be there, 99 yards, 6 catches.
Yeah,
kind of looked like the guy he was aiming for. But Burrow just, he looks ready for the NFL.
He looks ready. I don't say he looks ready for the NFL.
I think there are 2 young quarterbacks who look really ready for the NFL.
Oh, one is really good. I think he's playing as a veteran. He's playing as a veteran point right now.
You got to put Burrow in there. Burrow's looking really good, bro.
I would give him. I'm looking at him right now. I'm looking at him like an Andy Dalton. He's starting really good. He was a good quarterback for the Bengals. Let's see if he can be better.
Well, I mean, you can't judge him on Andy Dalton just because he plays for the Bengals. I mean, that'd be unfair because then you'd be judging Herbert based off of Rivers or even based off of Breeze or Dan Fouts.
Which are now...
Well, I get that, but Boomer Esiason also played for the Bengals, and he's a Hall of Famer.
Okay, well, we can pick him too, okay? I'm sorry that I don't know everybody in the goddamn
Phil
fucking
Phil Sims league. Played for the Bengals. Okay, he won Super Bowl with the Giants.
The fans are still looking at the nowadays quarterbacks, okay? And they looked at Andy Dalton for so long, okay? And they looked at other quarterbacks for so long. But
well, I mean,
I'm gonna wait till this year. If he brings the Bengals into the playoffs, if he does, then he is a great quarterback.
I would say he's a very good quarterback. I wouldn't even say he's a great quarterback if he does that. I'd say he's a good quarterback. I mean, he's got a lot of weapons too, with Boyd and with Umoza. I mean, he. Uzoma, whatever his name is, he went off.
CJ Uzoma.
Uzoma.
Uzuma.
Whatever. CJU. He came in and he showed off with 2 touchdowns. He's got the connection with Ja'Marr Chase right now.
Yeah, Ja'Marr Chase
connection.
That comes
from college, and I mean that right there just speaks unlimited amounts of what you can do on the football field with being able to have someone that has that kind of chemistry with you. So, I mean, Cincinnati looks like a team that could really shake up some ground in the playoffs this year. Them going up against Baltimore, who's also 3-1.
Yeah, but we'll just see how it is.
Like also with Cleveland, who's 3-1.
Yeah, 3-1. Cleveland's really good right
now.
That
NFC North looking strong.
But like I said, Joe, it's going to take a lot for Joe Burrow to compete right now because you got the Steelers falling, but you got the Browns rising. That no one expects for a long time. Let's just see if they can keep that spot.
Oh, yeah, we definitely have to see it. I mean, none of them played each other yet, and they play each other twice throughout the season.
Yep.
Which I cannot wait for those games. Cannot wait for them.
These rival games now are going to be very interesting with new players that are actually better than they were before because of these new players coming in. Like, you got to say, like, Justin Herbert, man. Like, we expect him to win against the Steelers. Well, not him, but Phillip Rivers expect to win against the Steelers or the Bengals. Like, I see that most of the time. But Chargers had bad luck with getting into the playoffs, but great records following with them.
This Chargers team looks a lot different than those teams, though. Exactly. The defense looks really good. Bosa on that line.
Bosa.
Derwin James and the secondary. I mean, they've got a really good team.
Bosa looked really good out there. He acted like a Aaron Donald mixed with a J.J. Watt, especially with that swat he did. That was more like a J.J. Watt thing.
Yeah, I could see that.
Very nice. I enjoyed that.
I could see that. I kind of saw a little bit of how DeMarcus Ware would kind of go around the end like that and bring his arm around to kind of swat at the ball.
I did enjoy that. That was a good game. Washington, I know you don't like talking about this, but I'll just do this, okay, so you can save yourself from trouble.
Lord.
Right? So Washington defeated the Atlanta Falcons 34-30. That was a good game for Washington because, like, I am not going to expect their quarterback to be that good. But Heinicke, 23 out of 33 completed passes, 290 yards with 3 touchdowns. no interceptions. Like, he did amazing job. Antonio Gibson did okay in my eyes, but then Heineken did run. You know how he is, jumping right over to the fucking corner of the post or or the flag post. He would just go sit right there, but...
Having McLaurin helping him out against that horrible Atlanta secondary.
Yep. But hey, McKenzie got that one big ass pass at that end that helped a lot for Washington.
Yeah, that was real big there towards the end of that game.
That was great.
And that was really big.
But Atlanta Falcons need to figure something out.
They played each other hard, but it was kind of watching, you know, two idiots argue. It didn't really matter in the long run because neither team's really that good.
Yeah, they're 2-2, and Falcons are 1-3. Yeah, so.
Neither team's gonna really do anything. They might, you know, but win down the road to hurt some teams, but.
But Patterson though, like. He's an all-around player. He's like a hill, but not a quarterback. He plays wide receiver section really good. He blocks really good as a tight end in the section. And he's a great running back. He had a touchdown last week for running. He has a touchdown this week No, he didn't have a touchdown this week. What was it last week?
He had three touchdowns for receiving.
But, like, he is a great all-around player, definitely doing the most out of everything, you know, 6 carries, 34 yards on the rushing, and then 5 receptions out of 6 targets, 82 yards with 3 touchdowns.
Well, you know, those University of Tennessee guys are pretty good in the NFL. What can I say?
Only if they can get into a winning team.
That's not their fault.
That's not their fault.
You just got to produce stats.
He does it. He does it. Kyle Pitts, though, it's for a tight end that's been talking really big. I don't know. Five receptions out of nine targets.
I think he's going to end up being okay. He's going to end up being a good tight end. I don't think it's going to be for Atlanta unless Atlanta can start building their team up and start getting some ballers on their team. Because right now their defense is not looking like it can stop anybody.
And Hurts doesn't look that good anymore with that fumble he made.
Mm-mm.
The fumble did not look good, I remember.
Hayden Hurst does not look good with that. I can't really say too much because Dalton Schultz, I about lost my shit on him. You want to talk about Carson? You want to talk about Carson fumbling? Oh, yeah. Dalton Schultz about got cursed
in
real life.
Yeah. So this is very interesting in ways. But the Buffalo Bills demolished Houston Texans 40-0.
Took the wood to them, absolutely spanked them. They were out there and they were just out playing pitch and catch. And
Mills didn't know what to do, throwing 4 picks, no interception, and no touchdowns. Like, just 4 picks alone. Come on, with only 11 completed passes, 11. He didn't even break 100.
The pain of not having Deshaun Watson.
The run game was terrible, but like Josh Allen, 20 out of 29, 248 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception, 1 sack with 103.8 passing rating. And the lead they had was so good, they had to put out Mitch Trubisky. Little Mr. Trubisky over here.
Mitchell Trubisky.
Love it. He did one pass.
And he completed it.
He completed it for 8 yards. So he was 100. He was 100. 100%er. Good job. But Singletary. I don't know why I say secretary. Singletary. David, 14 carries with 78 yards. No touchdowns, but Zach Moss got a touchdown. Josh Allen, of course, you know how he is. He runs a lot.
And Mitch Trubisky got his rushing touchdown.
He got his rushing touchdown with 4 carries and 10 yards, which is fucking hilarious. So
Stephon Diggs still looking like he's possibly one of the top number ones in the league right now. Up next to a Hopkins and probably a Cooper. And I mean, he's just looking really good. 114 yards, 7 receptions. Dawson Knox, 2 touchdowns in the game. Emmanuel Sanders coming up big. Buffalo just has a great team. Their defense looks strong, but then again, they're playing the Texans, and the Texans, they're hurt. They're missing players. Their confidence has just been beat. I don't think there's much left to Houston right now.
Nope. Until you get a better quarterback, Mm-hmm. You need to do something. You're just not going to be good. You're just not going to be good at all.
And it looked like they might have with Tyrod Taylor, but unfortunately, they didn't foresee him getting injured again, which someone should have. But they also didn't foresee Deshaun Watson being in trouble with the massage parlors in Houston, Texas, either.
Yep. That was fun. Like, that was a good game, but just for Buffalo's sake, it was a good game.
Only for Buffalo.
It was the Texans. I'm sorry.
Just like only Detroit Lions fans can understand what it's like to be a Lions fan.
And that's what they still did on this Sunday, because the Chicago Bears destroyed them 24-14. And it was a low-scoring game, but everybody looked good for the Chicago Bears.
We'll get to that game later. The Bears looked really good, but Detroit looked like they've just lost their heart as well. They don't look like they've got much fight in them. Jared Goff did okay, 299 yards, 24 out of 38 passing. But he's not getting any help from the receivers and the touchdowns. He's not getting any help from the running backs and getting some pressure off of him in the rushing game. Defense is not stopping anybody. I mean, Justin Fields looked like he was just having fun out there, 11 for 17, 209 yards. He had his interception, yeah, but Montgomery had a heck of a game in that run game. 23 carries, 106 yards, 2 touchdowns. But, you know, Justin Fields, is he going to be the future for Chicago still? Or are they, you know, thinking that he can do it? I think he should do it.
I think he should do it too. Like, I think we should move away from Andy Dalton. I think we should move away from Nick Foles and figure something else out.
That's not what Matt Nagy wants to do, though. He wants to put Dalton in there and let Dalton run the offense. So what are we missing? Is he actually seeing something we're not seeing? Or
I think that they're not used to having a running quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
For a long time, they had a power arm quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
Never a running game. And they weren't that good for a running game. They went, like, for quarterback running.
Mm-hmm.
They had good running backs. They had good wide receivers, good quarterbacks. But, like, they just were old style. They can't get into the new style. And I think his offense is built more around into, like, a passing coverage than a ability or agility to move around. So I think that's probably his weakness, is that bringing a quarterback in that's more running and passing than just passing and improvising.
I think having a quarterback that can do that to be able to extend plays is the best option. And Justin Fields, I think, does that clearly a lot better than what Dalton does.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Dalton also might be the better decision maker at this point, and that's what Matt Nagy's trying to get to.
I think he's just trying to save his job.
The extension of the plays does a lot, and it's hard to be able to trust that in somebody. Because if you remember, it's very hard for people to want Lamar Jackson at first to go in over Joe Flacco, because people didn't really think that Lamar's game would transfer over as well into the pro football game as like it was in college.
Yeah, but then again, their playbook moved a lot. Like, it changed a lot.
It changed after they ended up putting Lamar Jackson in. They knew they needed to ride that horse in the race.
Yep. They had to just focus on just his run game and just play pistol formation. They got rid of the whole, like, if you go back to, like, the playbook before Lamar Jackson, it wasn't all run. It was passing.
Oh, yeah, the quarterback never did any option plays. There was no RPOs.
There was no RPOs.
Lamar Jackson and Patrick Mahomes have perfected the RPO now. The RPO was pretty much perfected by them at this point.
Mayfield did a couple in the Browns.
Well, Mayfield can run the ball, but you don't have to worry about him as much running the ball as you do them.
Yeah. But then again, before that it was
Vic. But then again, Vic wasn't doing RPO in the sense of faking a handoff. Vic's RPO is, I'm either going to run or I'm going to pass.
Well, I'm like Wilson, too, you know. Wilson wasn't like, he was more of an improviser quarterback. He wasn't, he was before Patrick Mahomes and Lamar Jackson.
Mm-hmm. But, well, I mean, we could go but you are right. Doing that back and forth.
Well, you are right. Like, to be the true running game, like running pass player is Michael Vick. Mm-hmm. Like, he's Madden proven that us.
Yeah, he broke year. Madden. He broke Madden. He was the Madden player. Yeah, but, you know, I just think it's time that they need to go ahead and quit with the notion of having Justin Fields on the bench and having Andy Dalton on the field playing. I think they need to go ahead and put Fields in and do what he needs to do.
Yeah, start building around him. Don't get these other quarterbacks you already tried last year. In. You already tried this last year. Why do you need to do it now? Doesn't make sense to me.
Doesn't make sense to me.
So, but onwards.
Surprise game of the weekend. So for me, anyway, I thought Miami was for sure going to win this game the way they've been playing here lately. But Carson Wentz, good on you, man. Good on you. 228 yards, 2 touchdowns. I'm glad. I'm proud of you, man. Proud of you.
I'm not even proud of Wentz. I'm not even. Only player I'm actually excited for out of the Colts was Jonathan Taylor.
Well, Jonathan Taylor too, but
Jonathan Taylor he's improving so much. His power game is really good, and then when he's out there on the side, he's catching those balls too. Like, I just don't believe in Wentz that much.
Mm-hmm. I don't believe in him being a franchise quarterback, but, you know, it was good to see him get a good win and get some confidence for him.
I'm just pissed off, you know, at the Miami Dolphins at this moment. And it's not because, you know, it's Miami Dolphins. It's because of fantasy-wise. I'm pissed off.
Okay. Gaskin, how you like that guy?
Just three yards? 3 yards? That's
three
it?
3 yards.
And Gesicki, bro, like, you got the touchdown. That's cool. I do appreciate it. And 57 yards. That's cool. I do appreciate you getting up there. I like it. But God damn it.
It's not enough.
It's not enough. And I it's whatever. The Colts, I'm proud of you guys getting the win. Fuck Miami for right now.
He's a little sour, ladies and gentlemen. His fantasy weekend did not go very good at all. It was a 0-2 weekend in fantasy. But you know what? At least Renfrow had a good game.
You can blow. You can suck a dude's dick, bro. Like, you can definitely do that, bro. I hate you right now. Just for that.
You love me, bro.
But let's go to Cleveland and Vikings. Cleveland 14 over the Vikings with 7 points. Man, Baker Mayfield looked pretty good, but not that good. The defense was showing up.
Boring game.
It was showing
up. Ever watched.
The defense, man. The defense.
The defense showed up. I mean, you could say that. They held Minnesota scoreless after the first. But, man, that was just one of the most boring games I've ever seen in my life. Nick Chubb had 100 yards. Kareem Hunt had the touchdown with 69 yards. Dalvin Cook only had 34 yards for the Vikings. Alexander Mattinson only had 20. So their run game wasn't there. Kirk Cousins looked like he couldn't complete a pass to anybody after the first quarter. But, I mean, it didn't really hold a lot of my attention this last week. I kept kind of going back and forth and just kind of expecting to see something and kept expecting until the clock ran zero.
Yeah, it was one of the boring games in that factor. But let's go on your little NFC.
I'm not happy that they won, but I am.
Why?
Because it's cool to see them beat the New Orleans Saints, because I don't really care for the Saints. Saints have never been a good favorite team of mine. I just don't really ever care about them. But New York, giant football team, gets their first victory of the season over the New Orleans Saints. Daniel Jones, 402 yards, passing, 2 touchdowns and an interception. You kind of shut everybody up about him being able to throw in the NFL, didn't he?
Yeah, he did shut up everybody, because everybody else was talking about the reporters from last week, from week 2 to till now.
Mm-hmm.
They were just talking shit how bad he was. He can't mm-hmm. throw it anywhere. He can't even run. Like, they were just blaming on the offense and blaming him.
Mm-hmm.
But throwing 400 yards and bringing a win for 27 over 21. Ah, man, I think he did shut up some people.
Overtime victory, too.
Yeah, it was an overtime victory, and that was pretty good.
Saquon with the big overtime touchdown there at the end.
Yep.
Which, you know, say what you want to about Daniel Jones and him not showing up, but Saquon's got to be a guy that shows up as well. you can't just keep on expecting Daniel Jones to, you know, be the guy who can run the ball and pass the ball. If you got someone like Saquon Barkley, who's supposed to be a prolific running back, and that's why you spent a second overall pick on him.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got to be able to do something. He's kind of done worse than what Zeke has done.
Yeah. Well,
if I'm being honest.
He is. Well, the thing is, though, he did have two bad surgeries back-to-back, mm-hmm. week two, season two and season three. But, man, I just want to see how he is. We're just going to wait a little bit longer for that because he is trying to get back into it after, you know, blowing his both knees.
He is, and, you know, he did show a little bit of more movement, more elusiveness in the game, a little bit of power as well. He powered his way in for that touchdown at the end. Mm-hmm. But Alvin Kamara, you got to feel bad for that guy. Had 120 yards rushing on the day. He had zero touchdowns. I mean, guy was out there running his heart out. Couldn't get anything to going for his offense. Jameis Winston, I don't think he can get it done, man. I think they need to put Taysom Hill as the number one. I think it opens the offense up more.
It does open the offense more, but Taysom Hill did have three attempts. One of them was an interception.
I mean, one was an interception, but, I mean, you got to get him out there in the field more to be able to read the defenses.
True. But then he did run for two touchdowns. That one that touchdown, he broke seven people. Like, he just...
The strongest quarterback ever. That's what I'm saying. He needs to be out there doing it, man.
That's where he needs to be. Kamara gave him a lot of break with 26 carries, 120 yards. No touchdowns, though. But that was Hill's job. That was Hill's job for a while. Callaway, though. Like, Callaway was impressive. You know, he had those two targets, but major on the 74 yards.
Mm-hmm.
He was open. He was open most of the damn time. And I enjoyed watching him.
Yeah, Marquez Callaway, he's a baller. No doubt about that.
So going back to like you said, New York.
New York, New York.
I feel bad for all the Tennessee Titans fans out there, but you guys got demolished by 27.
How do you do that, Tennessee?
27-24.
How do you do that, Tennessee? Against the New York Jets. How do you do that?
And Zach Wilson did look crappy in the beginning, but then he came back hard.
I mean, he did a good job. I can't lie. He did do a good job. Henry did a good job for the Titans, but 33 carries, you got to have over 100 yards at that point.
You have to.
You got to quit handing the ball because he's going to be nothing by the end of the year.
Yep.
I know that you got A.J. Brown hurt and Julio Jones hurt, but someone's got to step up. Someone's got to be the number one guy.
And
got to want to be the number one guy.
Who showed up that they're still good, even though they let him go from last year. Tennessee Titans let go Corey Davis.
Yep.
And Corey Davis got signed by the New York Jets.
And got his revenge on him.
Got his revenge. Four receptions out of seven targets, 111 yards with one touchdown.
Yep.
He was everywhere. Same thing with Keelan Cole. He was everywhere, too, with three receptions out of four, 92 yards.
Yeah, Jets didn't look like a bad football team. I'll be honest. They did not look like a bad football team. Need to work on their run game a little bit better. Zach Wilson, rookie quarterback, you don't want him throwing, in my opinion, over 30 times in a game. You want to be able to have a good running game, take some pressure off of him. That way he can use the play action and open things up. So we'll see how the Jets continue to build their team up the rest of this year and into the future with him. But congratulations, Jets. Tennessee, go back to the drawing board and figure out what you got to do because you're making my Super Bowl pick for you look really bad right now.
It was interesting, but like, I don't know. It's just the Jets, man.
Jets, 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 Jets.
And I can't wait for next week for that one. So, well, we're gonna go on to a team that is right now the lowest. They're last place in their own division, and that is KC,
the reigning AFC champion, two-time AFC champion. Kansas City Chiefs, looking like they're balling team in their own division right now.
Yep.
Not conference, division. Yep. But, I mean, looking like they were wanting to try and come back and do some good things. They come with a win against the Philadelphia Eagles, 42-30. Could have been really bad for them if they lost this game.
Yeah, but, man, Patrick Mahomes and the offense still blight up with five touchdowns, one interception.
Yep.
And come on, man. What can you say about hell? What can you say about hell?
What can I say about him? I can say that Hill is the best receiver, obviously, on their team and can do anything he wants to on the football field because he's so fast that no one can keep up with him. So he'll run one way, make you run that way, and then he'll run back before you can even get stopped.
Yeah.
Hill's just a great receiver, elusive, will fight to catch the ball. So three touchdowns, 186 yards on 11 receptions. Get out of here with that crap, Tyreek Hill. Get out of here with that.
He'll throw it downhill because Tyreek Hill's down there.
The Heisman Trophy winner last year, rookie receiver Devontae Smith, 7 receptions, 122 yards.
He was not bad. You know, that's he was crazy. But then again, who was his quarterback back in college?
Well, Jalen Hurts for a little bit. And then he went to Oklahoma.
Yeah.
But yeah, Jalen Hurts was his quarterback, and so they do have somewhat of a chemistry with each other, which is kind of what Cincinnati's doing right now. With Joe Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase.
Yep.
So maybe there's something to looking and seeing who's good dynamic duos in college teams and trying to see if you can't get them in on the same team with you in the NFL and use that chemistry. It seems to be working out.
Yeah, that is true. It seems like it is working out.
I mean, the Eagles didn't get the win, but I didn't think the Eagles with their team could beat a Kansas City team if their team was clicking, and obviously Kansas City was clicking. Though they did get 30 points against them, so that did show a lot of spunk for them.
But it did show that that KC defense don't look that good.
No, the KC defense does not look good.
And that's a bad problem. You can't just let Mahomes do everything.
That's why they're 2-2 right now.
Yeah, that is true. It's really fucked up.
Yep.
For the next game, I am not very happy about, but it's whatever. Arizona Cardinals defeated the Los Angeles Rams 37-20.
Now, to be honest, would you have been happy with the outcome either way? Because one team was going to be 4-0.
Yeah, one team was going to be 4-0. I wasn't very happy with this game matchup, the way they were going.
You kind of wish that there would have been like a
loss somewhere.
Like an earthquake or something.
Yeah.
A sinkhole just opens up in SoFi Stadium. Both teams lose.
Oh, that'd be awesome. It'd be so awesome.
Yeah, Arizona Cardinals look like they're the most dangerous team in the NFL right now.
Yep.
Their offense looks good. Their defense looks like it's a shutdown defense. Can make mistakes happen. I mean, I don't know if there's a team better than them right now, to be honest with you.
I think there is a team that is better than the Arizona Cardinals. I just gotta wait for a little bit longer. It's not my team. I'm gonna lose against the Rams one way or another this year. I will. But hopefully it'll be in a circumstance that it doesn't blow us out of our playoffs. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, that's the only thing I'm scared about. But then You got Matthew Stafford playing amazing, better than he was ever in the Lions.
I wouldn't say better than ever, but he's looking really good. He looks a lot more comfortable. But last Sunday's night's game, that defense had him very uncomfortable, having to make him move out of pocket, trying to find receivers open against a really good secondary. Almost looks like they've got the no-fly zone back open again down in Arizona.
Yep. But Chase Edmonds threw, oh my God, 12 carries Chase, with 120 yards. Like, he was...
James Conner with 2 touchdowns.
Yep, James Conner, which is...
AJ Green coming out with a nice appearance for Arizona.
That was a crazy good touchdown too, because he got hit hard. And yeah, he literally stood up and like looked at him
and
like,
just kind of like just walked in the end zone like okay.
And Randall Moore did get some good yards with only 3 receptions with 28 yards.
Yep.
But Kyler Murray still acting like a fool out there, you know. He's just
Kyler Murray. I mean, that's extension of plays.
You do get set.
And then you got the chemistry of him with Cliff Kingsbury as his coach, who was his coach in Oklahoma, where he won a Heisman Trophy.
Yeah, so that's a good chemistry between them when they had back in college. Yep. So
the NFL might need to start looking into that chemistry stuff. There's just something about it.
Yeah, so you were right, though. They had to move Matthew Stafford out of the pocket a lot. But the thing is, though, they did not sack him.
They didn't sack him, but he had to get out of it. And when he did, it made things a lot more difficult.
Yeah, but he still ran up for six carries for 21 yards. Mm-hmm. He did pull out 21 yards off his ass.
That old bastard better watch out.
Yeah, he might get knocked the hell out.
He runs against Chandler Jones too much, and it's not going to be very good for him. Or Buda Baker.
Nope. Well, Buda Baker, God, he was just too good.
Baker is, probably the best safety in football right now.
Yes, on top. The best. So Baltimore, you know what, I'm proud of them that they broke their record.
Well, they've tied the record.
Oh, they tied the record. They
yes
didn't break it.
That's over. That's where Denver fans and Denver coaches are very upset with Baltimore is on a record chase right now for the most games with over 100 yards rushing. And Baltimore, at the end of the game, even though they had the lead, they knew it was one, decided to run an extra play to get over 100 yards rushing. Mm-hmm. And they got it. But due to the unwritten rules of sports, you just don't do that stuff. To me, I say get yours, because how many times has this record been broken? Not very often.
Mm-mm.
And if you can break it, cool, break it. And if you're the team that has to deal with it, well, you know what? Just deal with it. You're paid millions of dollars to do that.
Yeah.
So, Baltimore Ravens, good job. You guys keep surprising me with how many injuries you've had and how many changes you've had to make to your team that you guys can still hang in there. Lamar Jackson looked like a quarterback last week, had a really good passing game, rushing game. Not as strong, but still have to worry about it when he gets out of the pocket. Marquise Brown, great catch in the end zone.
Oh, that diving catch was amazing.
Beautiful.
But, man, Drew Luck got hit hard.
Unfortunately, Teddy Bridgewater, man, same with Jimmy Garoppolo. You guys are just, you're beat up, you're old, you can't handle getting hit hardly anymore. Man, it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate, Broncos fans, because you knew what you had with Locke, and you knew it wasn't good, and you got Bridgewater. You thought you might get Rodgers. You're upset. Then Bridgewater comes out, making you guys 3-0, and you love him, Bridgewater, and he's got all this going on for him, and then he gets hurt again. I'm sorry for you guys, but Cortland Sutton looks like he's going to be a problem for some defenses for Denver if they can get a good quarterback.
Yeah. And Fant, too. Fant got that touchdown. It was a nice touchdown cut when he did.
Fant is a big target for him.
But, man, those running game, the running game for Baltimore does not look that good. But then again, look at their lineup. Like, that's who started for Baltimore Ravens.
Well, there's no J.K. Dobbins. It's Latavius Murray now.
It's got Latavius Murray. And then right behind Latavius Murray, you got Le'Veon Bell. Le'Veon Bell or Le'Veon. Le'Veon. I know there's like two different ways he says his name. It's just weird. And then they got Devontae Freeman. If you guys remember him, he played for the Atlanta Falcons during the Super Bowl time. And he had amazing yards. Like, he was scary. Like,
yeah, he looked like he'd be a problem back then.
But now, man, one carry, 4 yards for Devontae Freeman. Bell, 4 carries, 11 yards. And then Lamar Jackson had 7 with 28. And then you got Latavius Murray.
Latavius Murray, yep.
With 18 carries with 59 yards.
Yeah, Le'Veon Bell kind of just pissed his career away when he left Pittsburgh. Went to New York for money.
Yep.
He just kind of pissed his career away.
Yep, he did.
He left a really good team to be on a really bad team for money.
Yep. And was behind a quarterback that everybody else thought he was terrible, and that's Sam Darnold. And look at Sam Darnold now.
Yeah, that is true. Adam Gase, someone needs to find you and beat you. You need to be caught in an alley somewhere in New York with a bunch of New York Jets fans, and they need to knock you on the ground and kick you repeatedly.
So, I know you don't like the Packers, and I really don't like the Packers that much either, but I'm going to be proud.
That's not what I heard Sunday.
But I'm going to be proud of this game because of two reasons. It was Aaron Rodgers with Randall Cobb. History was made back in the day with those two players, and they had that connection on Sunday with Randall Cobb getting 2 touchdowns with 69 yards, and Aaron Rodgers doing 2 touchdown passes to Cobb. That's it.
And Pittsburgh got gypped on a blocked field goal return for a touchdown.
Yeah.
They got gypped. They got gypped.
No, man.
He timed that.
Dude, you want to talk about
Watch it. You
can
tell.
You want to talk about bullshit
There's a lot of them. It's killing me.
Dude, like that fucking call. Okay. So,
either Bosa called him out and knew he was going to get in trouble.
Yeah, and the funny
part. And they won the game.
and the funny part is, dude, on Monday night, dude, you see that fucking penalty? Do we watch Monday
Yes.
Night? Dude, that face mask? What face mask?
Yeah.
What face mask?
Yeah.
There
was, right here?
Yeah, like, grab
right
the fucking collarbone.
Oh, this is on his shoulder,
what
yeah.
What the fuck kind of shit is that?
Yeah, people were going, oh, that's that might be a horse collar if they think that it is. And then it comes up with a, oh, it's face mask.
The fuck?
That wasn't even in the conversation, ref.
Yep.
What are you talking about?
And it's just, there was like three other calls during that game that was terrible.
Well, I mean, the Cowboys got away with one, too. Dalton Schultz definitely fumbled that ball when he got hit. He definitely fumbled that ball. It was out in the air. Jeremy Chinn made one of the most perfectly technical tackles you could ever see in your life. If someone was to teach you how to tackle, they would use that video because he put his face mask right in the middle of Dalton Schultz's gut where the football was and lifted him off the ground, and the ball was in the air just flying around. And they said that his momentum was stopped. Forward progress was stopped, so they called it down. Oh, yeah, sure. Thanks for helping us out this time, refs, instead of jerking us around like you did on the catch.
But Aaron Jones didn't look that good in that game, though. You know, 15 carries, 48 yards, but he did share with A.J. Dillon.
A.J. Dillon had some plays on him
like
that looked good.
He looked good. Like, they gave him some rest for a little bit and see what's up. And Davante Adams only did 68 yards with no touchdowns, 11 targets. With only six carries around that, six receptions, it's just...
Pittsburgh, you got to get off of Ben Roethlisberger.
You got
to. No matter who you use at this point right now, because Ben, just not the guy.
Yep, you got to get rid of him. He is old.
I would use him...
He can't throw more than 50 yards anymore.
I would use him as a consultant on the sideline. I would not use him for anything more than that. All right, you guys might not want to use Josh Dobbs or Rudolph, but find somebody, because Roethlisberger is not going to do it anymore. He's old, guys.
Yep.
He's old.
He's done.
It happens to everybody. Father Time wins.
So.
And then we talk about Tom Brady and Tampa Bay about Father Time and look what he's doing.
Yep.
Breaking records.
Tom Brady and company with the Buccaneers showed that he is the boss against the Patriots. In
New England during a monsoon.
Yep. And it was pretty... It was pretty damn close, man, but man, he missed that 56-yard field goal.
At the end.
Oh, if he would have made that, it would have been perfect. I would have enjoyed it.
I would have. I was hoping it was going to happen. I didn't want Tom Brady to lose. I picked New England.
I know, but like now Tom Brady has beaten every team in the NFL.
He's beaten every team in the NFL, and he now has the most passing yards recorded in NFL history.
Yep, and he surpassed the most, last week this happened, which is pretty fucking awesome, that he surpassed Brett Favre's record of most sacks.
Yeah.
So, hell yeah, but I'm feeling Russell Wilson might get there faster.
If he keeps playing for Seattle, that's a guarantee.
Hey, don't say Seattle, okay? Just say offensive line. We can get rid of the offensive line. We just can't get rid of Seattle.
I mean, that's how Seattle is anymore. It's been like that for years, buddy.
Oh, fuck off.
But, you know it has.
But Buccaneers beat them 19-17, and Tom Brady did play okay in my eyes. Okay. And, man, Belichick was running out of ideas in my eyes because he had no rushing game at all.
Are you kidding me? He ran so many different wide receiver reverse passes and stuff like that. He was going for everything. He wanted to do everything he could
to
get the
Tom.
Patriots to beat Tom Brady.
Yep.
I mean, everybody threw the ball in that game.
Yep, everybody threw the ball.
But then again, as Lou Holtz said a long time ago, if you're running trick plays, that's because you ain't got nothing else that'll work.
Yep. He had nothing that'll work to defeat Tom Brady.
Yep.
It was pretty bad. I don't know, man. I'm glad they won. I just hated that game. It was all about Tom Brady. It was all about Tom Brady.
Yeah, you couldn't go 5 seconds without hearing Tom Brady this, Tom Brady that. And it was really starting to drive me crazy. But
so it's this right here. This is interesting as hell to me. Because we talked about Herbert a while ago.
Mm-hmm.
Chargers defeated the Raiders 28-14.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think Justin Herbert is MVP?
No.
Why? No. Why?
No.
Why do you think he's not MVP? Or would you think he
right
is
MVP? Now? Like, do I think is MVP right now at this point in the season?
You say Kyler Murray on with kicking the teeth.
Well, you better get your kicking shoes on.
Well, I don't need to.
Because Kyler Murray right now is the MVP of the NFL.
I don't know, man.
Kyler Murray
he's
is
got
right
too
now
many,
the MVP.
He's got too many weapons. That's what the reason why. If you give Herbert two weapons and a running back, look at that.
If you want me to be honest, who is second in the running? Dak Prescott.
Man, I don't want to hear this shit anymore. All right, so like, all right, so
I'm just being honest, bro.
You son of a bitch. All right, so Derek Carr did do terrible. He played terrible. Like,
only well, that break, Chargers defense.
Yeah, the Chargers defense
handed up to them. They came out ready to just eat somebody alive, and Derek Carr was on the menu. I mean, he was running for his life. Had four sacks. Had so many hurries on him. Did the best he could with what he had. 196 yards, two touchdowns, interception. I think the best play Las Vegas had was the punt that was a fake that Renfro defended on.
That was crazy.
That was a really good play by Renfro, and he laid the wood to that dude. I don't remember who it was, but he laid the wood to him.
Dude, he straight up like lined up as a punt, and then he looked at the formation, noticed that no one was covering or even on the person on the far right, he literally just, you know, creeped up a little bit.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden, he noticed something. He was like, all right, they're moving back. All of a sudden, he hikes it, and he knows it was going to be a throw. He books it like a safety.
Oh, he did. And laid a hit like a safety.
Dude, he hit him. He looked, that looked that like looked, a miniature, like a mini Cam Chancellor
that,
out there.
That was like John Lynch out there running in and hitting somebody.
He hit pretty hard. And Herbert throwing some dots. I mean, he was throwing some overhead passes. And they're amazing. Over the running back, Eckler had a crazy good game.
Ruggs had 60 yards for Vegas, had a decent game, and Waller had the touchdown for 50 yards. Renfro, I mean, 45 yards receiving too with the touchdown. So, I mean, not too bad.
Yeah, for let's go back to fantasy football. For the past 3 weeks, we've been talking about Renfro and Ruggs the third. So we've been flipping back, and this week I figured, you know, Ruggs, you know, you did bad last week, so let's start Ruggs this week since it's been back to back. And Renfro outscored him.
But Ruggs had 60 yards. You gotta give him that. He had the yardage.
You know how much a touchdown is for points?
I understand.
How much touchdown?
I understand. I don't, but I understand.
Fuck you, man. Fuck you. I hope you choke on that Mountain Dew. All right, that's all I got to say.
Not a sponsor.
I hope you choke on that bitch. All right, let's fuck that. All right, so Waller did amazing. He was everywhere. He tried to catch him. He tried to be everywhere and got that touchdown at the end. Motherfucker. All right. Yeah. Silent, but deadly. Piece of shit. But like, hey, Chargers got the win, even though I choose the Raiders last week. It's whatever. Good job on that. Fuck you, Tristan.
Yeah, I know. He's trying to upset me. Anyway.
All right.
Let's get back to one game we skipped over, the Cowboys versus the Carolina Panthers.
We didn't skip that. We didn't skip that.
Oh, we skipped it.
No, we didn't. We talked about it in the beginning.
We didn't talk about it. We didn't get into no detail.
We want details.
Hey. Oh, we need details. We need to talk about the Zeke and the Dak. And
you already did.
Oh, we didn't get into all of it.
Why gotta be all of it?
Oh, because we got to get into all of it. That's the America's team right here.
Well, okay. So, like, Sam Darnold did amazing. He did two touchdowns. It was great. But like you said, Zeke Elliott, he did show up in that game, you know, 20 carries and 143 yards. It was amazing. And Cooper did have three receptions and, you know, 100% with 69 yards. That tight end section, though, looks still strong with Jarwin. You know, Jarwin did get that touchdown. Shorts got that touchdown. Mm-hmm. I wish I started both of them. but I did start one in my league. I started Schultz, and our league, I started Jarwin. So either way, it was a win-win. Okay. CeeDee Lamb, though, this a fucking point me. Because I had him, and he only had me with two receptions with 13 yards. Very bad. Why do I want to talk about this?
Because it's a great game. Dude, Panthers defense came out, looked kind of good there at the beginning, hitting guys hard. Dallas had to adjust. Dallas had a great third quarter. Great game. Beautiful game.
I'm just saying, it was a good game. I won this game.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't care.
Won because of my juju.
Because if you don't pick the Cowboys, they win.
Because if I pick the opposite team, the Cowboys win. This is scientifically proven right now, America.
No, it's not scientifically proven. Didn't you pick the Tampa Bay Buccaneers the first week?
And Cowboys lost on a technicality.
You gonna use a technicality on this?
The Cowboys are technically undefeated.
Don't listen to this, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, you're listening to this, ladies and gentlemen. Listen, America, to what I say. Or whoever's listening. You could be over in Australia, but listen to it.
Yeah. Could be a football fan.
But that's our recap for last week.
Yeah, that was a very good, interesting week, and it was a lot of good games. I'm happy our teams win.
Yep, and I know it sounds like we say this every week with the games, but the games have all been coming down to the wire. Nah. A lot of fourth down attempts I've seen a lot this week, too, and I've seen them previous weeks as well. A lot of people going for it on fourth.
No matter what position they are in, too.
On their own side of the field.
Only on their own side of the field, on the 40-yard line on their side, or...
The 25-yard line on their own side.
Yep, or... It's just like, come on.
The game changing that much? Are punters getting ready to be extinct?
Like, I feel like that might happen.
I mean, is the statistics going to prove that going for it on fourth down's better?
I hope not, because I do like punters. They're fun.
That's going to change a lot of stuff if that happens.
I don't know. They're just going to be fun. I just think that's how it's going to be. But other than that, like, I don't know.
Maybe they change a rule to where the quarterback has to throw the ball at least 40 yards down the field on a pass. Give the defense a chance to intercept it. Defense wouldn't try to intercept it, though. They'd try to knock it down. And that's what would get them.
I don't know, man. It's just... I just hope punters don't go away, man, because punters are so good. I like punters.
I mean, it's... Obviously, you know, NFL's always had punters, and you don't want to lose something like that, but if the statistics are showing that it's better to go forward on fourth down than to kick it, that's probably what most coaches are going to do now. It's like Moneyball. You don't have to have the home run king. You just got to get the guy that gets on base.
Yeah.
So, maybe that's what the NFL's doing. Who knows? I don't like that trend, but we'll see how far along it goes to the rest of the year. Maybe it starts, you know, getting dialed back a little bit more as teams start fighting more for playoff positions and trying to make sure that they don't do anything to jeopardize a seed in the playoffs, especially now since only the one seed is the team that gets a bye week first week.
Yeah.
So
that is true. It's going to be this week has been very interesting on games, and especially on the fourth downs, turnovers, just like it's just been crazy this week and last week.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully next week we'll see some more interesting games, because I know there's quite a few bad games this week, but it was a lot of good and interesting games and more, you know, exciting games. Mm-hmm. That was actually covering that.
Yeah.
But right now we're gonna take a little break and let you guys listen to our sponsors and our links and everything that Gerbil over here will take care of. So other than that, we'll be right back and
enjoy Gerbil.
Yeah, enjoy Gerbil.
Hey guys, it's Gerbil. Hopefully you guys are enjoying the KR scoreboard as much as I am enjoying editing it. But anyway, I was told to give you guys a little bit of an ad here about our wonderfulness over here at KR. So all the links are below of our store, our Twitch page, our pages anyway, Sir Cheese and KR. So feel free to go check both of them out, as both of us are on our journey to partner. So go check us out over there. Go feel free to go check out the YouTube channel. And of course, if you're on the YouTube channel, go check us out on Spotify and Anchor and any other podcast sources that they allow. I think we're on six, but I think we're on six total. So besides that, also feel free to go check out the Swear Jar, as the Swear Jar has now been moved to Thursdays. So the Swear Jar will come out on Thursdays, and the KR Scoreboard will take its rightfully home on Wednesdays. Thank you guys. Have a wonderful day and enjoy the rest of the podcast.
Welcome back, everybody. Well, we just got done talking about week four recap. We're going to talk about week five now.
Week five preview. Got some okay games, got some not so good games, and we've got a lot of really good games, to be honest with you, with some 3-1 teams going up against each other, out of conference, kind of showing us what we might have to look forward to in case we get to a Super Bowl with some of these teams. And we've also got a trip to jolly old London, mate.
Oh, fuck yeah. I can't wait for that game, because that game's going to be nice.
The Sunday early morning 9:30 a.m. game. If you guys are as much football lovers as what we are, make sure to set your alarms. Go to bed early Saturday night. That way you can see the great matchup in London of the New York Jets and the Atlanta Falcons. Like, London, I wouldn't be surprised if you guys wanted to start a revolution against us because of this game. I'm sending these teams to you. This is just absolutely just pitiful of a game for London.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to send them teams to teach them football. You're going to show the Jets and the Falcons.
But the Jets got a contract, though. Jets got a contract with London, with the NFL, and Jets are only pretty much the only, I think, well, Jets and the Jags are the two teams that go to London. But, like, It's going to be interesting.
Well, you know, the English have never been too smart. They got upset we poured some tea into the river also at one point in time, so.
Yeah. Well, so we're going to talk about the Thursday night game, which is, I'm happy it's my Thursday night game.
Yeah, you got a Thursday night game.
But I'm not happy who it's with,
though. I wouldn't be either. This is a big game for you, bro.
So we got Seattle at home facing the L.A. Rams. And that's a division game. You know, L.A. Rams are 3-1, especially what they did last week. And then you got Seattle with 2-2 with a good win over San Francisco 49ers last week to get them to third spot into the division to make San Francisco go last. So that's good. Hopefully keep that up. But, man, it's so hard to really tell on this game because Carson still looked weak. Matthew Stafford looks amazing.
Yes.
It's
split really right down the middle right now. Literally 49.8 to 49.8.
And it's America's choice on it's split down the fucking middle.
No one really knows what to do. You've got, you know, LA looking not so hot last week against Arizona. Is that because of how good Arizona is? Is that because LA, you know, getting a little bit more injuries with Henderson being out now and not being able to really compensate for a run game, not having him in there, helping Stafford out. Stafford looked really, really confused and really hurried out there during that Arizona game. So,
but I don't think he's going to have that problem with Seattle.
I don't think so either.
I think he's going to have a problem trying to find somebody open because Seattle's going to play a lot of zone outs. Mm-hmm. Maybe a few blitzes. You'll see a blitzes on first down and second down sometimes. Maybe on fourth down when it comes down to, you know, fourth and two, fourth and three. Because like you said before, there was no really punting involved at all. So you have to be on their toes every down. It's stupid. So right, and Henderson, I'm not going to say thank God, but as a Seattle fan, thank God. But as a person,
hope you get better.
I hope you get better, man. I know you're out for the rest of the season. I just got the word of, so I do apologize, and I hope you are feeling better. But, man.
He's glad you're out this game.
I'm just glad you're out this game, but that's not going to help us out because, you know, we don't have a run game either. Carson, you know, didn't play that much last week and, you know, fucking.
Run game didn't look very good. You got Metcalf with a foot injury. How's he going to look coming into the game? Is that going to affect him having a shorter week of practice and rest?
You've got Eskridge and Everett still out. You know, how are these guys going to be able to lift up their game for Wilson, who still looks like he's just one of the top quarterbacks in the league, just asking for help?
I was just hoping that Everett would be healthy for this game, because this would be a nice revenge game for him.
It would be a good game for him.
But other than that, like, my choices, man, I'm going to have to act like you for last week, is going to be – I'm gonna pick the Rams. I love you guys, Seattle, but, like, that Rams defense looks really good, and it's going to – and hopefully Wilson finds a way to win this for my Seattle sake. But the Rams will win this game with that defense if Wilson cannot do anything about it.
Yeah, you know, I'd like to pick Seattle for you to think that Seattle's going to win this game, but I just don't think that they can. I think the Rams had a bad week last week going up against one of the top offenses and one of the top teams in the league with Arizona. I think they bounce back this week and, you know, give some pressure to Russell Wilson in the backfield. I think they're going to do some terrible, terrible things to your defense. Matt Stafford's going to... He's gonna look like he's going to be an MVP candidate, I think, because your defense needs a lot of work on the line. Your defense needs a lot of work in the secondary.
It does. Yeah, I'm not going to fight on that. It really does.
So I'd like for your Seattle team to win. And, you know, the thing about it, Seattle's playing at home, and if there's a home field advantage for any team in the league, it's Seattle.
Who did you pick, freaking Rams?
Oh, I picked the Rams.
God damn, I should have picked Seattle then.
Oh, no, I picked the Rams. Oh, now you're looking at my pick. See? This is why I say let me know to begin with.
No, I was actually looking down here. I was looking up here. I didn't pay attention to this.
Oh, you looking at our record right now?
I was looking at the record because the record's fucking close, bro. Because you were kicking my ass last week.
I had a bad week last week. Went 3-3. You had a pretty good week, 4-2, on our 6-game pick. And, you know, we've got another 6-game pick with us having that London game this week, so maybe you might make up another game on me.
Yeah, maybe.
We'll have to see.
Just got to have to see. But that
other game be Thursday, won't it? Or the Sunday morning game. The Sunday morning London football game.
Yep, it's going to be the New York Jets facing the Atlantic Falcons. They're 1-3, 1-3. And America chooses the Atlanta Falcons to win this game.
Yep, Atlanta is probably going to win this game, but... You know, maybe you're right. Maybe the Jets have some sort of voodoo over in our home country of jolly old England. So
they even won in London with Gase or whatever.
Adam Gase. Wow. Adam Gase. Well, you know what? Then they definitely got some mojo. Gase won.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So like, I honestly think it might be the Jets to win this game.
But
having Zach Wilson, you know, not even have 1,000 yards yet, but 4 touchdowns, 8 interceptions.
Yeah.
And Matt Ryan with not even 1,000 yards either, but with 8 touchdowns, 3 interceptions.
That just shows you the maturity and level of play that Matt Ryan's been able to do his whole life.
But you got Davis as a good running back, but you got Ridley too. Ridley's been off the mark, but you can see Corey Davis starting to come up, especially from last week.
Yeah, young team that can, you know, do something good, you know, the Jets coming off a win, you know, they might be able to surprise a team over in London. I think Atlanta's just got too many bad places on their roster that can't really be fixed up with anything right now. I think next year there's going to be a huge roster reshuffle for them. Is Matt Ryan going to stick around, and is he going to retire? Is he going to go to another team when his contract's getting up closer to being done? We'll just have to see, man. We'll just have to see. So I think, in my opinion, New York's going to win this game.
I'm going to say New York, too, because New York has that mojo. They got the mojo in London. I'm going to believe in that shit, too, until I see a loss. And for my time since London's been hosting games there, the Jets and the Jags even.
Yeah. They've been winning those teams.
There's been those teams that win that over there, and I think it's
maybe they could send New York over to London and be the football team over there.
Yeah, be like the London Jets.
And keep Jacksonville down south and make them the Mexico team.
New Mexico, then they can use a team.
Move Buffalo just a little bit across the border and make them the Canadian team. And then you'd actually have a team to cheer for from your home country.
I hate
you. How about that?
I knew you were going to bring that up in here. you son of a bitch. All right, whatever. So what is the next game that we have to talk about here?
The next game is Green Bay at Cincinnati. Both teams 3-1 going into this game. This is our 1 o'clock Sunday game. Looks like it's going to be a really good game. Cincinnati's playing at home. They're 2-0 at home this year. Is Joe Burrow going to be able to keep his chemistry up with Ja'Marr Chase? Is Joe Mixon still going to look like a man unleashed at the running back position this year? You know, it a good possibility, really good possibility. Here's my thing. You got to go up against Aaron Rodgers, and Aaron Rodgers is just Aaron Rodgers. Yeah. I can't stand him.
I like hearing that. But, like, it's just for them being 3-0, it's going to be a really good game, and it's gonna, and Cincinnati has not lost against anybody at home yet.
Yep,
2-0. They're 2-0, and Packers are 1-1 on the way. So, like, it's going to be pretty hard. I'm going to pick Green Bay on this because it is Aaron Rodgers. It is Davante Adams. Aaron Jones did bad last week, but A.J. Dillon did okay. I did enjoy that. But Joe Burrow, and Chase is going to be...
Joe Burrow. Go Joe.
Those two, Chase and Joe, are going to be really good. They're going to have that connection. They're going to have at least two touchdowns, even though Chase didn't have a touchdown last week.
He did not, surprisingly, but, you know, Cincinnati does look like a team that loves to play at home. Looks like their home loves having them there, loves having Joe Burrow. You could really see the future in him, I believe, of that team. I would not be surprised if the Bengals end up winning this game. But I also wouldn't be surprised if the Bengals are winning and the Packers come back and beat them. So that's what I got to go for, is I got to go for the Green Bay Packers.
We're going to pick the same thing. Why do we have to pick the same thing? Why do we have to? I hate you for that. Well, America did pick Green Bay over the Cincinnati Bengals. But, man, it's like I said, it's going to be an interesting game.
It is. It's going to be a fun game, I believe. At least I hope so.
I hope so. I hope it's not going to be a blowout. Fuck, I'll be upset if it's a blowout.
Yep.
So what is the next game we got to do about?
Next game, we're sticking with the Ohio teams. Cleveland Browns versus the Los Angeles Chargers. Another game of 3-1s going up against each other.
We've been talking about the Chargers a lot this season.
They keep surprising people with how good they are. I mean, I didn't expect them to be as good. But I expected them to show a lot of improvement with Herbert. I thought Herbert was a really good choice for them at quarterback. And, you know, he's really shown out. He's got almost 1,200 yards passing, 9 touchdowns, and 3 interceptions on the year.
Nope.
So,
and Baker only has 2 touchdowns, 2 interceptions.
Yeah, Baker's not really looked like a really good, you know, quarterback, but he's been looking a good game manager.
I guess who's the leading receiving yards for the Browns?
Who's the leading?
Kareem Hunt.
Well, you know, that's not a surprise. He's a check down guy. He also plays out at receiver. You could do that when you've also got a running back like Nick Chubb who can play in the backfield.
What if you're playing like a lot like wide receiver and running back section, especially with two running backs that are a really good duo together? It's hard to really follow that.
And, you know, give it to Cleveland. They've been able to adjust their playbook around to where they can really use those RPOs with having guys like Odell and Kareem Hunt and Nick Chubb. And, you know, Mayfield is one of the better guys that runs an RPO in the league with, you know, this team. So Cleveland's got a good team on offense. Their defense looks like, you know, they're solid. They did a good job shutting down Kirk Cousins after the first quarter last week. Miles Garrett looks like a monster on the defensive line. So Cleveland looks like a really good team. I just got to give it to the boys in blue, though, because Los Angeles, guys, calm down.
and I'm gonna have to choose the Chargers also because, man, the Chargers look really good. Justin Herbert's really he's going off. I love it. I just love his work.
Mm-hmm.
And the way he's throwing those balls into the pocket, the way he has his vision looking at the left side of the field, noticing there's no one open there, and he knows that there's another wide receiver or another route that's coming right through there that's going to be open.
Mm-hmm.
He knows it, throws it, and gets it every time. He did that twice during the game mm-hmm. last week, which was amazing. I enjoyed it so much.
Yeah, he's shown a lot of progression from his freshman year into his sophomore year now.
For the NFL, yes.
Yep. Next game coming up would be the Sunday night game. Your Buffalo Bills versus the Kansas City Chiefs. Buffalo, big win last week. A lot of points, but against a horrible Texans team. Kansas City played really good, scored a lot of points on Philadelphia, but had a lot of points scored on them. That defense looks really weak. What do you think? I mean, you got Josh Allen over 1,000 yards passing this year, Mahomes over 1,200 yards passing, Mahomes 14 touchdowns, 4 interceptions.
Josh Allen's got 9 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. It's like, it's not even just the passing, too. The run game's a little weak. Like, I figured Singletary would do better.
Yeah, well, I mean, he had a big week the week before, so I can understand that.
And then Edward Clare, oh my God, you're just a Chris Carson.
Yeah, he is.
He's just a Chris Carson.
He's really, no pun intended, dropped the ball this year.
But Tyreek Hill, and it's going to be so hard trying to open that guy.
Tyreek Hill and Stephon Diggs, both of them looking good for their respective teams and showing out that they're true number ones. I mean, Hill, big week last week, 186 yards receiving. I mean, God. I mean, that's just ridiculous. Guy getting close to 200 yards receiving in a game.
Yeah.
I mean, by the 100th yard, you would expect someone to be guarding him with two people.
And the best part about it is that Buffalo is number one in their division right now, with Miami being 1-3, New England being 1-3, and New York being 1-3.
Yep.
And they're 3-1. Like, mm-hmm. It's going to be kind of crazy, a 3-1 facing a 2-2.
Yep. This Buffalo team looks like they're the New England Patriots right now in that AFC East, not really having to worry about the Jets or the Dolphins or Patriots, but that NFC North, or AFC North, man, 3-3-1 teams. That is tough to go through, man. And really good 3-1 teams with Cleveland, Cincinnati, and Baltimore.
Yep.
Really good teams.
I just said, well, it looks like America picked Buffalo over KC,
mm-hmm.
but just a smudge, like 58.7 to 48.9. So I figured that'd probably be right down the middle.
I can't say I'm surprised that it's almost split down the middle. You know, Kansas City is still Kansas City. You still got to worry about them. They still got a dynamic offense. Thing I worry about, if they can let the Eagles score that many points on them, what are they going to do when Buffalo plays them? Because Buffalo's got a lot better offense than what Philadelphia has. So, in my opinion, Buffalo is going to come out. It's going to be a tough game. It's going to be at Kansas City, at whatever you want to call it. I'm going to still call it Arrowhead Stadium because that's what it is to me, and it'll always be Arrowhead Stadium.
It is.
Oh, it's now called Gaha Field at Arrowhead Stadium.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It used to just be Arrowhead Stadium. That's all it needed to be called. That's all it needs to be called, Arrowhead Stadium.
That's funny as shit.
So I think it's going to be a tough game for them at night in Kansas City on Sunday, but I just think Buffalo's just got the better team.
I'm just going to have to pick Buffalo also, you know. seeing what the defense looked last week, didn't look very good. So I just, for them facing a better defense, like you were saying, it's just going to be very bad. I'm not going to like it at all. I know. I know you picked Buffalo. And I know. What are we right now? Oh, my God.
You know what? We're not going to have any separation this week. Because if you pick Indianapolis, you know you're going to lose. Because if you think Indianapolis is going to beat Baltimore, you're high off your rocker.
No, I'm picking Baltimore in that one.
Well, thank God. Well, we've picked every damn game the exact same, so
I can't deny on the games it makes sense. Made sense. You can't just, like, get away from it.
Well, I've got the lead going into next week. I already know that. No surprise, everybody.
That's fine. That's all fine.
Right, well, do we want to pick another game?
No.
Damn it.
No, because Why? Do you really want to?
You know what?
No, I'm doing it. No, you can't switch. You cannot switch.
I'm doing it.
No, we'll pick a different
America.
Game.
America.
We'll pick a different game.
No, America, I'm doing it. I'm doing it, America, because it's 2-3-1 teams, okay?
Are you picking Cleveland? What are you picking?
I'm picking Cincinnati.
Oh, my God.
And I'm picking Cleveland. And I'm going to laugh when both of those teams win.
Oh, God.
We got our separation now. I'm doing it.
Oh, you had to switch it like that. Come on.
I'm doing it.
I was just going to give you an extra game.
I mean, we can still do the extra game if you think you got it in you.
No, because you can't change
No.
it. It's not going to work.
Well, you know what? It's going to be okay. But let's talk about this game we've already picked that I think America's already picked too, because it's no surprise to them either with 67%. Going to against 32% or 33%, Baltimore over Indianapolis. I mean, Baltimore's been so lucky these last few weeks, being able to get some of these wins. But Baltimore, man, they are going to absolutely make Indianapolis look embarrassing. That defense is going to shut down Carson Wentz. I think, you know,
the defense
for Indianapolis is okay. I think they're good. But I don't think Carson Wentz is going to do very well. I don't think Taylor's going to do very well. I don't think Pittman Jr. is going to do very well. I think it's just going to end up being Baltimore that ends up running the show over here.
Yeah, I just think that's going to – yeah, Baltimore's going to win this game. They're going to run – they're going to make this an easy game tonight.
Yep, and it's in Baltimore Monday night game. Baltimore always shows up in the night games, so
mm-hmm.
You know, for me, it's got to be Baltimore.
Yeah, it's gonna be.
That's one I couldn't change. I could change a 3-1 versus a 3-1. I can't change a 3-1 versus a 1-3. you ain't got me that fucked up.
All right.
So with that being said, let's get into what we have decided to do this week, which is our power rankings.
Yep.
Our top five, bottom three.
Yep.
If you want me to go first, I'll go ahead and go first. I'll do my bottoms first. The bottom teams in the league, number three, I would put the New York Giants. New York Giants, I know you guys won last week, but don't get too ahead of yourselves. It's not going to be a reoccurring trend. You guys are going to have a horrible season, and you need to start planning for the future on your defense. Your offense can be good, but you need to get rid of one person, and that is Jason Garrett. And this is coming from a Cowboys fan, okay? If you keep him, that's awesome. We're going to win. But if you keep him, you're not going to win because Jason Garrett is not a good offensive coordinator.
For who?
The Giants.
Oh, you just picked the Giants as third?
Yeah, they're my third team in the bottom three.
Okay.
My next to last place team is the Detroit Lions. Lions fans.
That's your second?
That's my second.
Well, okay.
Lions fans, I'm sorry. It's not going to be a fun year for you either. I hope you guys can get some wins, especially against the Packers. Even though I did pick the Packers to go to the Super Bowl, the only reason why I want that to happen is because I just know Aaron Rodgers is going to do it for them. And that's why I picked them Super Bowl, but I would like for you guys to get at least two wins this year against them. But I don't think it's going to be very possible. You guys don't really have a very powerful offense. Jared Goff is working with nothing. He now knows what it's like to be Matt Stafford. So, Detroit, you are my next to bottom team. And my number one bottom team, the Jacksonville Jaguars. If you guys end up keeping Urban Meyer this year, I'll be surprised. If you keep him past November, I'll be surprised with some of the things that have been said and what's happened out in the world. And if you guys haven't seen, he's gotten some hot water here lately, but you know, Trevor Lawrence, you need more weapons. They traded away your receivers, and they've traded away almost everybody that you had good on your defense the last couple years, and you've really not got anybody to refill those positions and replace them. Not anybody good anyway. So,
yep.
Jacksonville, gosh, you guys might have to move to England just to have fans. you might have to be the London whatever. I don't know. London tea bags.
London tea bags.
They like tea over there.
God damn it. Well,
so that's my bottom three. What's your bottom three, so Cheese?
My bottom three is going to be very interesting. So we're going to do third place, of course, since you did it weird. It's going to be... God damn it. It's going to be tough, but... I'm going to say the Jets.
The New York Jets. That's not a bad...
the Jets are going to be the third... Because you got that one win, but I don't think they're going to have lots of wins this week. This year, so I'm hoping... Next year they're gonna have a good pick, but other than that they're gonna be the least three.
Okay,
so.
That's a good pick. I can agree with that one.
And then for the last one, I'm gonna have to pick the Lions. For the second one, it will be the Lions.
Detroit, good one.
Because you know they have bad luck. They're not gonna do much good this year at all, like they did last year, and then the year before that, and the year before that.
And it's just mismanagement of teams and.
Yep, it's just been very
players,
bad.
It's just yeah.
Then last place, I'm going to say also the Jacksonville Jaguars, because that is just being very bad this year. Urban Myers, like I said, he's not a very good coach at all. Don't like it.
I'd have to agree with you. Go back to college.
Yeah, go back to college. Definitely go back to college.
Go play teams like Purdue every week.
Yep. Instead of trying to face the NFL, where to him it's like, oh, I got to prepare. Like, I'm facing Alabama every week.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, everyone got drafted from Alabama onto these teams. So, what do you expect?
Yeah, exactly. So, what is your power three?
My top five in power top rankings. Five. Top five. At number five, my boys in blue, America's team, Dallas Cowboys. I can't put you up any higher. I really debated on even putting you in this week. I wanted to put you, obviously, but I didn't want to because I got to keep things going with the juju that I got for you right now. But high-powered offense, you got top defensive player, in my opinion, top rookie defensive player. Dallas just looks like a team that is almost kind of built for destiny this year in ways. So let's see how that rides out. Obviously, you got to keep your quarterback healthy. So, Dak, please don't get injured this weekend against the Giants like you were last weekend. So, Dallas would be my number five team. My number four team, they lost last week, but I still think it's the Los Angeles Rams. Stafford, like I said, he had a rough time with being chased out of the pocket a lot, but I think he's still going to get more and more comfortable with this offense and with Sean McVay. I also think that their defense was a little bit surprised with how good Arizona's offense is. I think the next time they play, they'll be a lot more prepared to be able to stop Kyler Murray and keep him more contained, and figure out a way to contain the receivers when Kyler Murray breaks containment, just because they're just that great of a defense. I think they can do that. So Los Angeles at number four. Number three, Aaron Rodgers, get out of here. Green Bay, number three on my list. I hate them. Number two, Buffalo Bills. I didn't want to talk about Green Bay anymore.
Oh,
number
two,
Buffalo Bills. They look like the best team in the AFC to me right now. So, Buffalo, you guys get number two spot in the power rankings. And number one is the last undefeated team, the Arizona Cardinals. Arizona, you've got a great offense with so many weapons. Your defense looks opportunistic with being able to take away the ball on interceptions and fumbles and being able to use your lineup the best of your guys' ability with Watt on the line and Chandler Jones at linebacker and Buda Baker and secondary, just controlling everybody and showing everybody where they need to go. So Arizona just to me looks like they're the best team.
I like those choices. Those are pretty damn good choices. I don't like the whole, you know, NFC West, but no, Seattle. You know,
well, I mean, Dick. Be better than 2-2, and I can put you in there in
that's
the top
funny.
Five.
That's funny. All right, well, thank God we're just doing it, you know, per my perspective. all right, so my power five is, my number five will have to be the Dallas Cowboys. Because they are improving a lot. I'm not going to lie. They are improving quite a bit. The Dak Prescott did show a lot. He can throw the ball and not throw a lot of mistakes like he did last year and a couple years before that before he got injured. And then you got Zeke Elliott, of course.
Surprising last weekend.
Surprisingly just got up and decided to go up. So I'm pretty proud of that. The defense is still being number one, so I'm pretty proud of that too. But we'll just see how it goes. That's the reason why you guys are five.
Yep, that's exactly what I said.
Number four is Seattle Seahawks. I am sorry, but they defeated a division rival, and that is pretty proud. Okay, that brings us that brings them a lot of faith because they were going into the same game also. So that's showing them that they can defeat their divisions, defeat their rivals, and hopefully this week on Thursday we can defeat the LA Rams. Number three. God damn it. Like, that's a tough one. But I'm going to have to say the Packers. The Packers have to be my number three. Aaron Rodgers, of course. And Davante Adams. He's just going crazy. And then you got A.J. Dillon going off, just like Aaron Jones every week. It's going to be tough to deal with that offense. And the defense looked pretty damn good. Even though they don't have their left outside linebacker, Devontae Smith or some shit like that.
Za'Darius Smith?
He's Za'Darius Smith, yeah. And then my number two will have to be the Chargers. Because, come on, they got up there. They're showing that they have a potential team to actually go to the Super Bowl playoffs and be, actually, if they don't have or don't even want to go to the playoffs, they have potential just defeat teams to not get them into the playoffs.
That's good. That's a good pick. I would have left them as my honorable mention. That's kind of where I have them. They're almost there, but with how young Herbert is, I still kind of reserved on choosing them to be in my top five just yet.
I can believe you on that. And then, like I said, we're going to make this quick. Arizona. Kyler Murray and A.J. Green. Hopkins. And then, you know, of course, having Connor and Edmonds just going crazy from last month. So, not Edmonds, but, Edmonds.
Yeah, Edmonds.
So, like, it's... If we can beat them, I'll be happy. We might be that one team like the Cowboys was when they went undefeated, but they have two losses. Who are the two losses against to?
Get out of here.
It was the Giants.
Get out of here.
So, that could be... the potential.
Possibly.
And we can still be enough to get into the wild card. That's the only thing I'll be happy about. If we can get to the wild card, get into the playoffs, we're happy.
You know what? I really would like to get that divisional round, but as long as Cowboys get in the playoffs after last year, yeah, I'll take it. I'll take it too. we differed on the New York teams for the bottom three, and we differed on the LA teams in the top five, and you picked Seattle and I picked Buffalo. So no love for the Bills. And a little too much love for the home team, in my opinion, but let's see. Power rankings of the year.
Let's just see how it is.
How things go next this coming up week, and then next week we'll have to see who moves up and who moves down.
Yeah. We'll have to see that because we're going to have to do this every week now.
Yeah, so. Who moves up, who moves down. Ooh. Watch these power rankings, everybody. These are not ESPN rankings. These are our own rankings.
Yes, we're not going off of the websites or anything.
We're doing what we want to do.
All that I'm looking at the website right now, or even what's up popping up in front of us, is just the standings. That's it.
Stats. We've got all of our wins and losses. I mean, we do the homework, guys. We got this stuff. Yeah. This ain't us just bull crapping around.
Well, since I end the podcast quite often, like every time, how about you try to end this one?
I end the podcast this time. Well, I will do my best. I'm not exactly trained at being able to talk about all the sponsors and affiliates that we're part of, but I do know that we are on Spotify. I do know that we are on YouTube. I do know that we are on Anchor. And if you guys would like to follow us, click a like, click a subscribe, click a... whatever it is that gets us more views, you know, do what you need to show the appreciation, you know, not only to me and myself, but to everybody, you know, in the background, behind the scenes, doing all the work. you know, show everybody love on doing that. Show them that, you know, you care about them as well. So get on there. Tell us what you like about us. Tell us what you want to hear more of. As we've talked about early on in the beginning of this KR Scoreboard podcast, we'd like to branch out and do other sports besides just NFL. And, you know, that really comes down to you guys showing as much support as you can. You know, we're sports guys. It ain't asking us to do too much to sit down and watch a lot of sports. So
yep, it's not a lot.
Please hit us up with the comments. Hit us with the likes and everything. I'd like to thank Gerbil for, you know, producing and editing this podcast. I'd like to thank Cheese for being part of this and allowing me to be part of this.
Always, man.
Awesome opportunity, awesome situation we're involved in right now. Everybody in the KR Army, thanks a lot. Thanks for supporting us. Go out, check their stuff too. Check out the Swear Jar. See what Jazz is talking about. See what Dooms is talking about. Even Marky Mark and Gerbil pop in every once in a while.
Yep.
So, you know, see what everyone's doing on that podcast and, you know, let them know what you want to hear there too. So, you know, just thank you to everybody, and thank you especially to you guys. You guys are the reason why we do it, because we want to be able to reach you guys as well. So, thank you, Cheese. It's been a pleasure.
Always.
Great weekend football coming up. Great weekend that we just had.
Yep.
And let's continue on with the year, man.
Hell yeah. Let's go this Sunday. We're going to have a lot of fun.
Have a lot of fun. But this is Darth from the KR Scoreboard with Cheese, and this is my shout-out to you guys. We'll see you guys later.
Yep. Have a good evening, morning, good afternoon, wherever you guys are listening to this. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful day.
And go Cowboys.
Go Hawks.
Go Cowboys.